Last summer, this elementary school learned that their well water was contaminated with toxic chemicals, so they switched to drinking bottled water. It's a situation that's playing out in wells, rivers, and lakes, and farms all across the country. The culprit? PFAS, or per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances. Basically any kind of carbon atom that's had all of its hydrogens replaced by fluorines. This compound's used in many products because it's extremely effective at resisting heat, water, stains, and oils. But because PFASs are nearly impossible to break down, every time we wash or throw away in landfill products containing them, they enter our environment and contaminate our drinking water and food supplies. They're so ever-present in the world around us that they're now in the bloodstream of virtually every single American. Since no level is safe, as these forever chemicals accumulate in our bodies, they're increasingly associated with health issues like birth defects and cancer. This is a look at this alarming problem, the ways Americans across the country are working to solve it, and some common sense steps you can take to prevent exposure. The danger PFAS poses came to light when a class action lawsuit showed that the chemical giant DuPont had for years been dumping thousands of tons of it into America's fresh water supply, even though they knew how hazardous it was. The settlement resulted in tens of thousands of residents participating in a study that found strong links between drinking water contaminated with PFOA and diseases like kidney cancer, testicular cancer, thyroid disease, and high cholesterol.
It's overwhelming. Every day, a new disease is tied into these endocrine-disrupting chemicals.
In a recent talk, Dr. Paul Segal explained the growing list of ailments his patients are suffering from.
There's a fairly good causal link between these chemicals and the development of not only obesity, but diabetes, cardiovascular disease, cognitive dysfunction, with an acceleration like Parkinson's disease.
Dr. Segal practices in Maine, where a farmer discovered in 2016 that his dairy cows were producing milk contaminated with extremely high levels of PFAS.
So I ran a milk sample, and that milk sample comes back at 1400. That was the second week of December of 16. That's when I knew we had a problem.
Stone immediately stopped selling his milk, plunging his farm deep into debt. He had to slaughter most of his beloved herd, cow families that had been in his family's care for generations.
That's the sad part. I mean, that's the one that really makes you cry. You take care of the land and the cows and the land will take care of you. Well, I think we failed him.
His health is now failing, likely from PFAS exposure, but at least he's not accidentally poisoning people anymore. So how did Fred's farm become contaminated all the way up in Maine, a state that doesn't even have any facilities that manufacture PFAS? The answer? An EPA program that allows wastewater treatment plants to get rid of their sludge, the biosolids left after human sewage is treated, by providing it to farmers nationwide to spread as fertilizer onto their fields. A recent New York Times investigation revealed that much of the sludge in the U.S. is contaminated with PFAS, and that one of the leading manufacturers of it, chemical giant 3M, knew PFAS was linked to serious health consequences, and that the company's scientists had discovered it in sewage all over the country. But when they shared this information with the EPA in 2006, the agency did nothing. 3M never raised the issue again and never made their findings public either. It's taken nearly two decades for this to come to light, despite EPA whistleblowers claiming they've known for decades that sludge application makes the soil essentially permanently contaminated. Most disturbingly, the sludge spreading program continues, with over 2 million tons applied annually on more than 4 million acres. Over the decades, farmers have obtained permits to use sludge on as much as 20% of all the farmland in the country. One farmer, forced out of business by PFAS contamination, told Ambrook Research, "Farmers were told sludge is safe, that you're foolish not to accept it. Often contractors did the application, so the farm didn't have to. There's no wear and tear on the farmer's equipment, no tax on the farmer's time. In hindsight, if it looked too good to be true, it probably was too good to be true."
Sludge is also marketed as compost and, besides farm fields, is spread on home gardens, landscaping, golf courses, athletic fields, and parks.
In 2022, Maine became the first state-level government to ban land application of sludge. Connecticut has followed suit. Other states now require testing sludge for PFAS, like Michigan, Wisconsin, Colorado, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Vermont, and Maryland.
States say the major challenges holding them back from doing a lot more are cost and a lack of alternatives for what to do with the millions of tons of this stuff our sewage systems are producing every single year.
Since Maine banned land application 2 years ago, 90% of its sludge is now shipped to the Juniper Ridge landfill, but the facility will fill up by 2028. New technologies like industrial dryers will help reduce the volume of sludge coming out of wastewater treatment plants. Sludge could also be used as a source of fuel for heating and electricity. But the most effective solution to limiting PFAS is banning it altogether. California, the biggest and most powerful state, has been a leader on this, outlawing its use in things like children's toys, firefighting foam, textiles, and cosmetics.
Here in Maryland, the state government is implementing a comprehensive PFAS action plan, but the state still allows sludge spreading, even though tens of thousands of farms throughout the region drain down through creeks and streams like this one into the Chesapeake Bay and the Potomac River, which flows down between Maryland and Virginia to D.C., the nation's capital, for which it supplies 80% of the drinking water.
At the national level, President Biden's EPA took some important steps to protect all Americans. This year, it established a legal limit on PFAS, requiring all public water systems to test for the chemicals and bring down levels to 4 parts per trillion by 2029, and the president's big infrastructure law provided funding to jumpstart these efforts. The EPA declared PFAS a hazardous substance under the Superfund law, which will encourage PFAS cleanups and make it easier for local governments to sue polluters under the Clean Water Act. And in 2024, the FDA worked with companies to get them to stop using PFAS altogether in food packaging in the United States.
There's still a lot more the federal government can do. We've seen how important it is when good people are in charge of the agencies that are tasked with protecting us from environmental dangers like PFAS. No matter where you live, though, beyond pressuring your elected officials to do more, here are some concrete steps you can take to prevent your exposure.
However you get your water, especially if you're on a well like I am, you want to test it. Certified kits cost about $300, but there are effective, affordable ones now on the market for just $80. I just ordered this one. I'm going to give it a try and have linked to it below. If your water does test positive for PFAS, you're going to want to install a filter. Now, a lot of newer fridges come with filters already inside of them. And if they meet the NSF ANSI 53 standard, they're going to help. And when it comes to your food, you're going to want to eat organic whenever possible, as sludge spreading has been banned on organic farms since the mid-90s. But to completely eliminate PFAS, we're going to need to fully empower our health and environmental agencies. On this, the last word goes to Dr. Maryam Taleb, the state of Maine's farmland protection specialist.
That my concern is that when we hit this point in the conversation of, you know, what does it take to change, we're talking about how the EPA has failed us. And what I don't think that often leads in the public conversation to is, and the next step is, they need more funding in order to not fail us. It leads to, they failed us, we're not going to reward that. So I do have concerns that these moments really don't serve us well in that argument. We have the opportunity to use them, but I don't see it happening. And I'm a little worried that we could use this opportunity, but it really comes down to, are we actually going to fund the EPA enough that they could do the research and not have to rely on companies doing their own? And I don't see that change necessarily happening.